afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another exciting propaganda cast from the host, Imperial Dane, Master Propaganda, Hero of Psych, Defender of the Fatherland. Rudolf, here's an exciting one versus one on crossroads. Between the south, you've got Nightclart fighting him for Germany, Deutschland, and the Kampfgruppe Walter. In the north, we got Kultoff fighting for the United States of America, freedom, democracy. And the 5th Armored Division here, we've got Mobile Defense, Lightning War, and Mechanized Assault there for Nightclart versus Coulters. Heavy Cavalry, Tactical Support, and Rifle Company with the Bulletin of Infantry, and Infantry all the way there for Coulter as well. Double Rifleman there, MD42 Grenadiers for Nightcloud. He was sitting elsewhere, see, but noting he's not making a direct move here for, say, the fuel point. He's actually just grabbing the points right next to his base. Initially, in fact, he might be planning to sort of move southwards and grab the points towards here, but just sort of wants to grab the territory to ensure he gets a bit of fuel and munitions that way, which isn't a half bad thing. But at the same time, not something the Americans will be pushing right away. There's it's sort of semi-safe here in the early game. Grenadiers arriving, so again, we see here more eastward, so clearly indicating east there, whereas for Coulter, it's all west, maybe south bit there as well. But two rifle squads there, fighting for freedom and liberty. Thank you for teaming up. Oh, he's going to rest. Oh! Going to be close here. In this case, the MD42 makes it. But in this case, they're roughing right outside. It's going to be tricky. He's going to need the Grenadiers up there to support. Otherwise, this is not going to work out for the MD42 in particular with more riflemen actually arrive. And there we go. We got the Grenadiers up to support here. There we go. Opening up the riflemen out in the open. Suppress them. Good, good, good. Pioneers need to jump to the top of the riflemen as well. Support gunners doing what they can. Grenadiers need to move up further. MD42 is taking losses there. More Grenadiers on the way here. Could be an early engagement, they could go in Nightcloud's favour and get up there to deal with the rifle inside the house. There we go, Grenadiers popping in, helping absorb some of the fire, shooting down the rifle. And there we go, close, but in this case, Nightcloud was able to pull it off. So, Coulter has gotten a few points, whereas Nightcloud has been laid across in that direction and won't be able to grab it. It's a bit rough then, of course, with this. Coulter gets a small fuel advantage, but on the other hand, with the first engagement there, Nightcloud should be able to grab more territory, thus quickly catching up, and of course he will have the manpower advantage having inflicted, well, not actually really, the MD42 suffered more losses here. I suppose it's more of a timing advantage. The rifle have to run back, then get out again. And now Coulter's back meaner than ever with three rifle squads. Will Nightclouds go for more Grenadiers here, or maybe another MD42 before then taking up? But there you go, three Grenadiers, one MD42 here versus Coulter's three riflemen. We got a mortar on the way there for Coulter, so he's going to add some light artillery support there to help deal with the Krauts, the Germans. MD42 operating very much in his own there, very risky play there, considering he's down to two men and low health. They don't like there what Nightcloud is doing with that one. That is definitely pushing his luck to where he can't really hold. A bit like Goering's belt. Anyways, Pioneers versus Rears, we've got the news moving up to support there, so more drought here for Coulter. And there you go. Rifle there, straight into the MD42, but we got more rifle in there, in fact, going right at the farthest arc of fire there. The MD42 alone health out in the open, and there we go. MD42 retreats, but right here, it's simply put too late for Nightcloud, and the result here is pretty much predictable. Nightcloud loses the MD42, Coulter snatches it, and dubs it the Freedom Gun 42. Grenadiers there grabbing victory points and fuel points here. So while he's losing in the east, he's gaining in the west, but the problem is the MD42 is definitely a clear loss there for Nightcloud and a clear win for Coulter, because not only does he wipe a unit, he gains heavy machine gun, whereas Nightcloud loses heavy machine gun to the enemy. So right there, that is a pretty bad development. And again, why you should always be careful about your MD42s being away from the rest of the army, particularly low on health and numbers. That was definitely reckless, cocky. Grenadiers being caught between a lot of riflemen if they're not careful. Need to be careful that, but there we go, mortar firing down here. So I mean, MD42 and a mortar for Coulter, he's going to be in a strong position, plus the rifle there. Nightcloud 7 going to be finding it from the back foot a bit there. In particular, if Coulter makes really good use of the MD42. Take up there attack. For Nightcloud, need to get the Pioneers back, and there we go, they are retreating. Grenadiers being forced away here as well. Grenadiers bring up for the cough point, just in case. Could have laid down some S-mines here to help defend that area a bit. MD4 twisting up, Grenadiers sweeping about here. Might try and get some of those riflemen here. A bit further pressure, and there we go. Coulter going straight for the captain. Hardly any surprise there. I mean, while the lieutenant is seeing more play overall, the captain is still very much Mr. Popular, because then you can get Mr. Stewart, and Mr. Stewart is really, 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 really good. And tends to be pretty much a no-brainer in terms of choices. There we go, MD4 to hold up the Grenadiers here. He's going to try and sort of make it into another wipe there. Go Mortify further prompts a retreat there. He should probably just try and grab the points here. Further nice for his opponent. Like to make a nice company. Bunker up here for Nightcloud. And Reichman sweeping into the west here, including some re-echelons. Mortar moving ahead further to the front line. Reifner reinforcing. And Captain here, just moving about there. Thanks to the fuel control, the Culture can't immediately rush out a steward here. So that's a good move there for Nightcloud overall there. That's definitely going to help him, give him more time. Otherwise, again, what Culture could have done is basically had the captain then supervise the steward and had it out in roughly 6 minutes, if not before. Which is basically the power there, again, of the captain, you know, as well. With the whole company command post, he can just rush out anything. And again, that means you can get out a really fast steward. 2-2 here for Nightcloud, taking advantage of course the fuel advantage, push out some light vehicles that way. Try and shift the sort of more mobile game into his favour with the 2-2-2s, though of course with the captain out he needs to be careful. And we got double mortars here for Coulter, an interesting choice there, a nasty choice that's definitely going to make it harder for Coulter, Nightcloud to use his infantry and turn in his support weapons upon themselves under a lot more pressure with two mortars out. Captain is attacking, so if he's not upgrading the captain as yet, gunners are being suppressed. We got Gunners moving up, pushing up against the reactions. There we go, 2-2 up here for Nightcloud. Another one on the way here. Gunners pushed back. Captain really gunning them down here with Thompsons and rifles. Need to be careful here with the 2-2. It is not bulletproof. Wow, crashing into the house there. Nice driving, Ludwig. Flame throws on the way for the Pioneers. Reactions almost wiped out, but they do manage to get away there. Mortar retreating. Threatened here by the heavy presence of German light vehicles and who knows what else. Second scout cart here for Nightcloud, so that's 2 2-2-2s. Panzer Grenadier could be a nice sort of follow-up choice here. Maybe another MG42 or some Panzer Grenadier. You could also very soon go for the flame for a half check that in here, try and burn out some of Coulter's units. Captain enemy engaged. Looks like there was no bazooka there, at least not in time. Grenadier's advancing. You need to be careful that he's moving into very hostile territory with only one Grenadier squad. I think right there Nightcloud was perhaps a bit too optimistic there about his options and chances with the Grenadiers. Pushed back, almost wiped out there. 2-2s in the south, just driving a bit aimlessly around for the time being. Neither side has yet to go for the drop. We got Mortify there, almost hitting the Reifman and Grenadiers here. Looks like they're going to be wiped. Is that turned up? Yo, no! Oh! Jeez, that was lucky there. Otherwise, I mean, that would have been a really bad decision to move forward then. Overall, it still was. But just to Reifman made it really much, much more worse. So plenty of manpower there, but looks like we're just getting infantry force of the Grenadiers. So hard to say we'll go for next. Always again, Panzer Grenadier there would have been, I think, a very good choice. Rifle grenade off. We've got bazookas on the rear echelons, but not on the captain. Oh, there we go. He's getting the bazooka. Just he's not reinforced because he's too far away from the base there. 2-2 firing at the end before 2 inside the house there. Perhaps trying to collapse the entire place, but again, taking a lot of damage there. Since again, the 2-2 is hard to call bulletproof. Turn the armor piercing rounds. Pack 40 on the way there for Nightcloud. Clearly worried about enemy armor. Knows he can't keep up this game forever before the steward hits, so he's bringing up the pack 40 just in case. Grabbing ports here though. S mine sun as well to help defend. Gute Arbeit. Bazooka fire there. That 2-2 risk getting knocked up. No, he pulls out the MG42 here. Interesting decision. Anti-tank gun has arrived. Oh, thankfully there, at least for the 2-2, there's only one bazooka on Coulter's reactions allowing the 2-2 to escape. And they're going to head straight into a lot of rifling up, some with BARs, and that prompts further haste retreat there from Nightcloud. Rifling it off in the mortar. Does a bit of damage, killed one, but ultimately nothing sort of more decisive there to force retreat. More Pioneers on the way for Nightcloud, still no Panzer going to deal, say an MG42. But again, with two mortars out, Nightcloud might not be too interested in the idea of an MG42 at the moment. On the other hand, Coulter's very interested in the idea of a light tank, and thus it brings up the M5A1 Stuart. Rolling that one out for freedom. Stabbing grab. MG42 moving downwards, 2-2 being repaired, Grenadier reinforcing, Pack 40 just waiting for somebody to deal with. Stuart advancing pretty rapidly and aggressively there. And we got tech up here for Nightcloud, trying to head for armor as swiftly as possible as his opponent. Steward on the roll, slowly patrolling, seeking out targets. Pack 40 Grenadiers, as it looks like Nightcloud's getting ready to push in the west. Maybe a push up here, or perhaps he's actually scouting out there for the Steward, hard to say here. But yeah, Pack 40's going to get caught here. Or not, oh, damn close. And there you go, Pack 40 spotted. Bazooka shots there from the rear. Pack 40 sets up, gets a good penetrating hit down the front arm of the Steward. Cunningham's advancing. 2-2 moves out. Another hit down the Steward, almost taking out there. Good work, good work. Cunningham's advancing with that machine gun in hand, ready to take on those Americana. And there you go, Ralph Grenade off. And a full wipe there. Full wipe. Good work there by Nightcloud. Cold wasn't paying attention. That saw a full wipe there against him. Rapid Captain moving ahead. Gerson's advancing. He's shot there by the 2-2 from the south as well here. They're falling in a bit of an awkward position. Needs support, needs cover. Gerson's still pushed back. And we actually got more men sort of retreating there for Kota for some reason. Hard to say why. We got an ambulance on the way though. We've got to treat the captain to speed up that production, by the way. Who wants to? MD42, they're covering the center, and the Pioneers swiftly suffer a loss there. Gunnelly's reinforcing, healing, support. McCall could go up now here for Nightclub. Looks like that's what he's planning. Gunnelly's Pioneer flame for support here. And overall, map control wise, Nightclub's in a pretty solid position there versus Kota, who's bringing up the ambulance. Chillerating down there, almost wiping out the Germans, but miraculously not really hitting a lot. Mostly hitting the truck. Steward being fixed up and good to go again. Still no doctrine from either player. Kota, no rifle, tactical support, or heavy cavalry company, though continues going for BARs, heavy cavalry, or rifle company would probably be good choices.
The enemy is overrunning one of our capture points.
Steward goes west. And in this case, hooks up behind the Gunnadiers, cutting off the retreat path, making that much more difficult for them to retreat. There you go, one kill. Panzerfaust, and there you go. Ends up the Gunnadiers, could have been bait, well, accidentally ended up something. Spit a line hit, introduced into a ride from the south, catching the Steward from behind. Exposing its rear armor. You got stun rounds. The problem is, this is too many T22s, and again, the rear armor allows him to quickly do a lot of damage. There you go, main gun is out. A disastrous development there for Kota. The Steward got knocked out here by the 2-2-2s. Good work there by Nightcloud, seizing upon an opportunity when he saw it. Kota in this case did not have any infantry working with the Steward, allowing him to swiftly sort of assault with the 2-2-2s without having to worry about anything else. Pack 40 being caught out in the open of the rifle from BARs. A lot of firepower there. 2-2-2s might try and move to keep the bit of bay, and there you go. Heavy auto cannon fire. Bit of correction machine gun fire, mortar landing as well. And there you go, Pack 40 wiped out. In the center, Gunnadiers might want to push forward here against the mortars. But the advance continues here, going straight for the Pack 40. He's going to try and steal it right under his opponent's nose. But rifle taking loss, we've got more Gunnadiers arriving here. The Pioneers close to being annihilated as well by the heavy Browning automatic rifle fire. Gunnadiers versus the mortars. Mortars in a pretty bad position there. Still, neither side chosen a doctor. Gunnadiers there taking a few hits. Rifle falling back. Rifle grenade, there we go, gets one of the mortars, excellent. And we've got more rifle grenades here. Full retreat there from Colt as well. Gun there's a Gunnadiers running into the house. Gunnadiers alone helped out in the open. Now there's the rifle inside the house there. And there we go, Gunnadiers pushed back. Freedom prevails. We got the support McCop, and he's going for the Austin first. Looks like he's just going to try and use that to counter the infantry, although honestly, he could go for the Panzer IV and that will perform roughly the same, but also be able to better deal with the infantry and overall get better veterancy. But oh well, Austin flak pans out here for the Kampfgruppe Walter.
We got a rifle squad waiting for orders.
Which was one of a series of flak panzers based on the Panzer IV. Sort of first one being known as the Möbelwagen, which can have a 30mm gun or a flak feeling. And there's the Wirbelwind, of course, which had the flak feeling. There's of course the Ostwind with the 30mm flak. And S1's there, took out a unit, at least forced retreat there. Good work. So a few fun facts there about flak panzers. Overall, the Germans operated many, but thing is, there was never a lot of anti-aircraft tanks, even with, well, I think any army really. And there's a need to retreat. And I think the most numerous one the Germans had was the flak panzer Gepard, which is based on the same chassis, the Hetzer and the Marder. It's almost based on this, the Czechoslovakian Panzer 38T. MG4 train setting up, going straight versus the Austrian, firing the edge 30mm flak straight at the MG crew. Almost wiping out the entire thing there, going annihilates and wiping out now versus the Austrian. Pioneers grabbing the mortar in the west here, 2-2 versus Captain Reifman. More Reifman, Captain moving up. lot of damage there, close to half health. In the rest of Nevis, the 2-2-2's an anti-tank, and here really would help Koltar maybe to tank up resource-wise. He does not have for that. Osman is cutting the SWAT gun in the center. 2-2-2's just hammering away there. Not doing too much damage, still propelling retreat there by Koltar. And in the center, Captain moves ahead. Shots fired at the 2-2-2's, but none of them really hit. Impressively. Osven's going to need some work though. It's time here for the mid-game analysis in terms of damage. Nightclaw's hit kills-wise. Nightclaw's hit, no surprises there. But overall, it's a better player there. A few mistakes there from Koltar rather sort of means that is to be expected. In terms of army value though, I mean, Koltar's still far ahead there. The BARs, the bazookas, all the support weapons. So again, we can still see Nightclaw's little sleeks in their hit there. The Osven hanging a bit of a role there, resource float-wise though. Nightclaw's floating a bit more than his opponent. Should be careful with that. And of course, points help though. I mean, Nightclaw's been able to sort of better control there. There have been a few points where Koltar sort of was ahead. But the loss of that Stuart in that way rather hurt Koltar quite a bit. Sort of meant he can't really sort of contain Nightcloud as easily. Can't contain the Osvent or the Stuarts there, nor the infantry. So he's, of course, more light than the infantry. He's got a lot off, of course, also by some of the large manpower bleed. And he hasn't, for example, brought up any anti-tank guns, which could always be quite helpful. Again, they do possess a very high rate of fire and lastly DPS, which allows them to take out, for example, 2-2s and 2 shots very quickly if an Wehrmacht player is not careful. So that was something there for Koltar to consider this a anti-tank gun up there. Doctrine, he also needs to go, you know, for something. He can't just sit about there just waiting for anything to happen. Rifle Company then going straight for the EC8 could be an idea there. He could, of course, also go what most American players go for at the moment, which is heavy cavalry, and, of course, play for the Pershing. The other very common choice is tactical support. The Calliope, though, Calliope here wouldn't help us so much. So, I mean, if you sort of follow what most players would go for, most likely Koltar would go heavy cavalry, then go for the Pershing and ignore every other thing in the Doctrine, which again tends to be sort of the key here. I mean, heavy cavalry has rather become, you know, Pershing Company, what's all those four other abilities about? Because I sure don't use them, roughly. I mean, if you just go for that, it could also give Nightcloud a small chance of pulling off something contained fuel control there, because that way he could build up a further arm advantage there versus him. Plus, again, he's not going to use them most of the Doctrine or the Rangers, combined arms, smoke, anything like that, which again, if Nightclaw then makes better use of another Doctrine, I mean, he can, you know, rule counter that pretty hard. So again, it's rather coming down to, I think, what Koltar chooses in Doctrine and then how he actually makes use of it, because again, a lot of players tend to flub it around there. So, I mean, much else to say about Koltar, but again, more harassment down here would be good. Maybe some more reissuance with bazookas, but otherwise, a part of me would say, you know, try and take up, though that's going to cost him quite a bit there, fuel control-wise. He's been struggling there. Again, he hasn't really put much effort into it, nor brought up any fuel caches. So in that sense, Nightcloud has been able to run a better fuel game, if you will, compared to Koltar, who has been a bit more monolithic and was just relying really on the rifle with the BARs and the Stuart, and then once the Stuart got cut down, well, Koltar lost a lot then, sort of lost a lot of momentum and sort of ability to pressure the fight more into his fight. So, in that sense, Nightcloud, I think, does an advantage now. What Nightcloud should consider is more armor. Again, setting up for Pershing Nevis of Stukes would, I think, be a very good choice here. Of course, we could also go for the Panzer IV. Otherwise, a few Panzer gun idea here, and obviously, you should choose a Doctrine. In that case, Lightning War would help him out nicely, I think. G43 for the remaining Grenadiers, tactical movement, relief infantry, Stukas, and a Tiger attack down the road if need be. So let's return to the fight and see what happens here.
Osven loaded and ready.
Tidus rolling up the west side again, gonna do supporting here. And there you go, it is Lightning War. 15-16 minutes into the game, we have the first stock, and that is from the German player, that is Nightcloud. From Koltar, we've got Bagarul. Osman being fixed up there. Alright, it's most anti-aircraft guns, those are self-propelled in the German army, would have been mounted on trucks, or even some armoured, or heavily armoured, well, not even heavily armoured cars, just cars. Field cars, as they were known. Porsche or something like that, I think they're called. 2-2 there with Grenadier support, push back the rifle, then the center. We got more push up there, relying again on raw force from riflemen. Overall slowing down a bit here, allowing the Osman several easy hits there with the 37 and a flank. Grenadier's been caught with the G43s. Pioneers want a bit of a loss there to Nightcloud and the Kampfgruppe Walter. Captain there getting blasted by the 30 mil flak, which is closing Mitch's one there. Go almost wipe the captain there. Rifle is pushed back there. Rifle moving about here as well. Mortar sneaking in. Gunnelly's moving ahead. We got a Panther 4 on the way there for Nightcloud. Osprey could move up here. In fact, could try and flank through here. Past the outhouse and sort of get past the American position there. Sort of fire into the flank, but so far seems like Nightcloud is using a more defensive posture. Back here, troops are being reinforced, and we find a gun, an anti-tank gun there for Coulter. M1 on the way.
Anti-tank gun.
There we go. Flak Panther got to those armies running. Mortar firing away. 2 kills. Veteran 2-1. Germans haven't yet to get much over there. American mortar. You know, Jürgen, I think you could do better. Yeah, but it says insert freedom here, and we only have mortar rounds. I think that's what they call the mortar rounds. Oh, in which case, I'll be doing much better next time. Do not worry. More pioneers there to replace once lost. Panther forming it with the pin bomb machine gun being added. Also, as a general rule in the German army, most of the anti-aircraft firepower was generally provided by the Luftwaffe, which operated large flak regiments and batteries to sort of be attached wherever they were needed. Though each division would usually also have their own sort of smaller anti-aircraft companies, in the case of the Panzer divisions, battalions, even regiments, sort of attached to them with bigger flak guns. But for some infantry division, it was mostly light flak. Dropping down the bottom from the Ostwind. Mortar fire there. I fought it close to being hit. Kind of these sneaking about. And two-to-twos here in the west with the pioneer support there. But there we go. He's just pushing forwards. They're relying again on raw force there, Mr. Coulter. Barging through recently being caught by the Osprey out in the open. Need to be careful. A lot of bazooka fire plus the anti-tank. And there we go. Osprey all of a sudden very low in health. About to get knocked out here. And there you go. Osprey is kaput here. Now, Clark perhaps underestimated Coulter's anti-tank response by this point. Lost it. Also, Veterans 1 here on the anti-tank gun. That's good. Opens up for take aim, which is, even when nerfed, a very potent ability, since still it increases range and increases line of sight, which is still really powerful. I'm still surprised most American players never make use of it. Fixing up the Panther 4 here. Morgan that is on the way there for Nightcloud. No Panther gonna be there. Mort being caught here by American Mort, but also the Americans, the actual Americans. Almost got the mortar there wiped, and we got the 2-2s here. Could try and move up behind them. Gunnelly's certainly moving up there.
Our lines of supply are
Captain pushed back. Almost got the mortar. Looks like the rifle will be forced back instead here. Heavy light machine gun fire from the Gunnelly's, threatening their lives in a matter of moments. Troops healing, reinforcing. And Colt here going heavy cavalry, which indicates he's definitely going for the Pershing. And most likely won't bother with anything else. Not say in ranges, mines, sandbags from his riflemen, smoke, and certainly not the ever excellent combined arms. But again, most players never seem to use it unless it's completely broken, which again says something about most players.
A capture point is under attack.
Anyways, Condesa supporting a Panzer 4 move northwards there. Pack 40 also covering, Mortar moving back up here. Rifle being pushed back there. Going ports. And finally, it looks like Coulter remembers there's also another side of the map. They're going in through there. Captain Rifle here, and he got on me from the captain, further boosting any troops near him. Mortar fire raining down. Coulter certainly moving rather sluggishly here. Bazooka hits us, the Panther 4. And Tatanka not knowing the bike, but is it taking hit, pushing westwards as well.
You now have Tiger tanks at your command.
Tiger tanks are available for Nightcloud. In fact, he might go for the next again. He can, even if he's gone for armor, because again, he actually uses resources more effectively early on, rather than just, you know, trying to play straight for the person. He overall just played well. I like to go both for an Osprey and a Panther 4, then get out a Tiger. Moving towards the center here. Gunnadiers here versus Rieschen, pushing them back. We got Rifle moving up here for MP4 2, something up to deal with the Gunnadiers. Back at base, more healing reinforcement. Colter, though, I think really has neglected just harassing his opponent here in the eastern side of the map. We're going to go for the card point down here. Rob knows the 2-2s, we've got double gun leaders bringing up again. Veteran 3 light machine guns for themselves on the Veteran 2-1. Plus the heavy autocannon fire, they might not last long. Rough knows we've got more rough moving up there, more BARs versus the Grenadiers. Between the tombstones and the mausoleums, they are ultimately pushed back here, simply too much firepower there. From Coulter, who's also grabbing the territories there, that should also further give him a bit more fuel and munitions, allowing him to actually go for the Pershing, which he can very soon. Though, of course, it's going to be tricky with a massive rifle force there, which again means a bit of a manpower bleeding going on. But again, he's got the fuel, he's got the command. Well, population just needs command point and he needs the manpower to then go for the Pershing here. And of course, the magical question is how does Coulter then utilize his Pershing? Because if he uses it incorrectly, like it is a German Tiger, he will probably end up losing. Since the Pershing is not that.
Enemy forces are securing our territory.
Re-Echelon's rifle moving up here towards the west. Panzerfaur moving ahead. And the tank they're firing there, going to use his take him and armor piercing rounds. Good, good. Almost got it there, almost got it! Almost, but at least this time we can't blame him for not utilizing his abilities when he actually had them at hand. So good work there, at least by Coulter. But they're going to continue to get right past MG42. Can almost get the Pershing in the meanwhile though. Nightclouds brought up the Tiger. And it's advancing MG42, push back, Riesa's moving up. We've got more Grenadiers, Rapp moving in from the north, plus more support here. And it's been called out in the open at the same time. We've got the 2-2 Grenadiers supporting up the west here. Grenadiers here dealing with the Riesa, preventing the 2-2 them from dealt with while they deal with the Rifleman there with their heavy firepower. Tiger blitzes up the center here. Rifleman can push back by the heavy armored might of the Tiger. Grenadiers almost being rolled out. Anti tank gun swipe. They're losing all of its precious veterans here. Now the Tiger there. Engages the rifle and pin bump machine gun on the way. Coulter still bleeding manpower, preventing him further on from getting the Pershing. And to tank and they're getting hammered. We are mortified there, troops healing, reinforcing. Captain sneaking westwards. But with limited support. At least he's got the fuel point down there, but again, manpower wise, he can't then actually utilize it. But Nightcloud's definitely in the dominant position overall. He's been playing the map better there than Coulter. Plus, he's been able to take advantage of Coulter's mistake better than he's been able to take advantage of Nightcloud's mistake. Plus, when Coulter did have the amount of riches, he could have made much better use of it. He actually then gone for docks and then pushed for, say, mines or sandbags, setting up further defensive positions, making it hard there for Nightcloud to get back on the field. Sadly, Coulter did not. And there you have, we got the M26 Pershing out here. They also existed the Super Pershing, which was basically a Pershing with a bigger gun and bolted on armor. Though there was only one that really saw action there on the Western Front. One did see action, I believe. And it is here versus the Pershing. And there goes Zen running. Good hit there from the Tiger. Panther Force supporting units is almost wiped out. Good hit there from the Tiger on the Pershing. Good hit in return from the Pershing. He's got the HVAC round. So Cortical's right here, go for combined arms, pop the ability, utilize the Pershing then with higher range and higher rate of fire to that way dominate the German armor. But do you think he'll use it? I suspect not, despite it being a pretty good ability. And there you go, instead he uses the HVAC round there. Almost got the Panther 4 though, pretty good work there, but needs to pull back the Pershing. Main gun destroyed. Pretty damn close to the rear, so need to get back as well. Panther 4 escapes here. Tiger down to half health. Where the rest of the force, they're just standing about, they're not pushing towards it, even supporting the Pershing here, in which case we might at least be able to get the pack forwarded. Captain needs retreat, come on Coulter, retreat man. And the captain is, no, he's dead, he's quite dead. Not getting back there, right now, then pushing upwards, staying to the Grenadiers and the 2-2s. Bit belated assault there, we got smoke being called in also as well. They could have done that on the pack 40, rather than the 2-2s here, bit of a missed opportunity. Grenadiers have been gutted in a matter of moments. There we go, 2-2 moving ahead. Working on the Pershing there, need to get the Riesens up to work it as well. There, good pushing back the Chili Tubes. I'm helping repair it for Nightcloud. On those three echelons, get them to work here, get them to work. They would definitely speed up the repair speed there of the Pershing. Almost got the two to twos, yes, firing away the bullets, piercing that thin armor. Panzer IV being repaired by a lot of pioneers. Over there, Nightcloud also displaying better repair tactics than Coldtoe, could at least have them repairing while being reinforced, thus speeding up the repairs here of the Pershing. Sun looking pretty rough here for the 5th armor. Their assault against the Kampfgruppe Walter has seemingly so far not succeeded and gone too well. Fixing up the Pershing, rough and reinforcing, healing up. Gold is out there with the Pershing, gonna use that in the open. Rough and charging forward, MG42 firing on as well. And rough grenade there. Pershing misses. Terribly and tragically. And this is their pushback by the Pershing.
Enemy forces are securing our territory.
Going back territory there, moving up the west again. Tiger almost picks up as well. Grenades looks like he's getting ready for another push into the center. Plus, he's now got the Stuart close air support there ready. Whereas Colt has got no real support here for his Pershing. Again, lack of any medium armor set up there prevents him from getting any more supported. Do it again. He's not really controlling the fuel points very well. And to tank going away there for Coulter, another one. Replaced one loss to the Germans. And we got another smoke screen down. I wonder where. Right there, it seems. Not sure what's calling in there. He's certainly not using it to prepare for an assault or anything.
Just got cut off.
Seems like a misclick. And there you go. Another M1 anti-tank out there for Coulter. Pack 40 Tiger there ready. As ever. Nightcloak, they're not really feeling for attacking forwards again. He's got really the victory point advantage, but also the recent advantage at the moment here with Coulter. Rapid pushing forwards into the Tiger's line of fire. Panther 4 joins in. Heavy fire there. Rapid being pushed back, and there you go. Pershing moving forwards as well. Good hit there from the Pershing, rapidly moved back by Gunnadiers in the 2-2-2. Veteran 2 on the American mortar. Almost on to the German mortar. And the Pershing's already pushing back there. Might go for the 2-2s instead. Try and deal with those. Probably should have done that sooner. But there you go, Luftwaffe support called in here. A few penetrating hits of the 2-2s against the rearm of the Pershing. And there you go, Panzerfaust as well. Aircraft moving in, there we go. Kanonenvogel getting off some hits, and there you go. Pershing down. Pershing down, anti-tank here on the field, but no armor piercing rounds available. No sapper rounds. Panther 4, they're taking hits.
A capture point is under attack.
And at this point, it rather looks like GG. I mean, he's lost the Pershing, he's got no immediate response to getting another one. His opponent's got a lot of armor as well. Does me look good here for Coulter. And there you go, GG, game over, victory for Nightcloud, a loss for Coulter. Coulter had some good moments in the early game, but the problem was they rather quickly fall towards just sort of covering the center a bit here, but overall not really sort of focusing on trying to sort of gain back the fuel game in his control after the initial successes of Nightcloud, meaning Nightcloud overall managed sort of, you know, speed ahead there of Coulter, build up a fuel advantage overall, allowing him to get up more medium armor but also heavy tanks than Coulter. Good, because again Coulter just didn't really do much around his own fuel points. He was so absolutely focused on sort of gaining the center that he sort of lost control of the rest of the map. And again, that's sort of a common mistake there, which again you have to be more careful about, you know. Otherwise your opponent can, here as Nightcloud did, quite nicely take advantage of it and sort of punish you for. And of course, losing the Stuart there was definitely a huge loss there to Coulter. And definitely also highlights, you know, what a well-handled 2-2s and Panzerfaust that can do if you absolutely have to. So well played there by Nightcloud. Overall, punished Coulter for his mistakes at every step, every opportunity, and just hounded him from moment to moment. Overall, he was much more focused, less on the center, though he would, of course, take it if he could, but it's very much more centered around actually gaining control of the fuel points, or at the very least denying them to Coulter, that way securing a fuel advantage to his opponent, thusly ensuring he could actually, you know, bring up more armor and armor first than Coulter could. So, I mean, overall, very well executed strategy there from Nightcloud over his opponent. So, there you go. I hope you enjoyed this match and learned something from it. Bit the best I could find here at the moment, since there's a patch up which pretty much wiped my entire pet replay archive at the moment. So, of course, that's also a bit of a limiter there, but hopefully, I'll be able to bring up something a lot more exciting tomorrow. But still, I thought this one, you know, still had a few good points to make there about play. And again, you know, how American players tend to pretty much at the moment only go for the Pershing and they'll really even go for Rangers anymore, but I'll certainly not make use of the otherwise excellent combined arms. And again, that one could probably also help a bit that few times. But again, I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, like, you know, subscribe, like, share it, comment on it, of course. This is Imperial Ancient. Cheers. Thank you all for watching. Hope to see you all tomorrow for another exciting episode. Cheers.